Hey everyone, I'm Jordan Feigenbaum. You're watching Barbell Medicine. You stay classy there, you two. All right, hey everyone, welcome back to the Barbell Medicine YouTube channel. I'm Dr. Jordan Feigenbaum, your host. This is vlog number 29. We've got some questions that you guys have submitted, some form checks that we've gotten from you, and also some of our own training that we'll review. Make sure you stay tuned to the end of the video to find out how you can submit your own questions and your own form checks to be answered right here on this vlog. Now, without further ado, let's get into some questions. This first question is from Liam Prasad. He asks, in your nutrition lecture and to be a beast post, you reiterate that fasting in between meals appears to be necessary to reset or prime your muscle protein synthesis response. With regards to this fast, do you have any clarifications on drinking water in between meals when trying to maximize muscle protein response? Further, is there any nuance there with low calorie drinks in the 4 to 12 calorie range, such as black coffee or diet sodas when consumed in between meals? So I actually think this is a really good question. And there are a few things we need to kind of cover before we get to the final answer. So first off, what actually is muscle protein synthesis? Muscle protein synthesis is the incorporation of dietary amino acids, which made their way into the bloodstream, and then the muscle effectively creates new muscle protein out of those dietary amino acids, which was previously dietary protein. The rate at which it does this is the fractional synthesis rate. Each event is called a muscle protein synthesis event. If you are fed, if you're in a calorie surplus, if you recently exercise, so this post-exercise period, especially from resistance training and protein ingestion in general, all tend to favor muscle protein synthesis. And in fact, with resistance training, we tend to see an elevation in muscle protein synthesis rates for about 48 hours until they return back down to baseline. And that's especially in newer trainees. Now, when you become more trained, you're more experienced, they tend to last a little bit shorter, so 16 hours, 24 hours, but that is not until someone becomes more and more trained. This whole process, muscle protein synthesis, is opposed by muscle protein breakdown. Muscle protein breakdown states are favored when you're fasting, when you're working out, like right when you're working out, because you're actually sort of breaking down muscle tissue when you do that. And also hypermetabolic states like burns, hyperthyroidism, stuff like that, all tend to favor muscle protein breakdown. In order to gain muscle, we actually need more muscle protein synthesis than muscle protein breakdown. That net sort of gain or loss is dictated by that struggle between muscle protein synthesis and muscle protein breakdown. Now, dietary protein ingestion tends to signal muscle protein synthesis, and I think it'd be interesting if we took this magic school bus ride to find out how. So dietary protein is ingested and makes its way from the mouth down the esophagus and into the stomach, where some initial breakdown of those intact proteins occur secondary to the enzyme pepsin. From there, the chyme, which is partially digested food in the stomach, travels into the small intestine, where enzymes from the pancreas break down the protein into its constituent amino acids. Now, sometimes these the protein that was previously intact gets digested into dipeptides and other short peptides. However, once those things make its way into the cells lining the small intestine, they're ultimately broken down into free amino acids. From there, the amino acids basically get absorbed from the small intestine and the cells lining the small intestine into the bloodstream, which results in an increase in the blood level of amino acids. We call this hyperaminoacidemia. So effectively, after you eat a bunch of dietary protein, boom, hyperaminoacidemia occurs in the bloodstream. An increased amount of amino acids in the blood favors transport of amino acids from the blood into the muscle, which produces a complex set of hormonal and biochemical reactions we call muscle protein synthesis. In humans, it takes about 30 to 45 minutes for muscle protein synthesis rates to increase after ingestion of like a whey protein, but it does so readily. The muscle protein synthesis rates go up by about threefold. Again, that's 30 to 45 minutes after you actually ingested the protein. And this muscle protein synthesis event, the rate at which you are incorporating dietary protein into muscle, lasts for 30 to 120 minutes before it returns to baseline, where it remains at baseline despite any additional influx of dietary protein, even if it's administered by IV. So in effect, you have this muscle protein synthesis response that occurs after you eat. It takes about 30 to 45 minutes for that to kick off, and then it stays that way for another 30 minutes to up to 2 hours before it returns down to baseline. And no matter if you give yourself more dietary protein or if you infuse protein into the bloodstream, it doesn't go back up. It effectively stays at baseline. Based on the existing evidence, there appears to be a need for this metabolic machinery and all those biochemical reactions that make up the muscle protein synthesis response. It's thought right now that it just needs to reset, and it takes about 3 hours for it to do so, 3 hours from the time of ingestion of a dietary protein source. One theory as to why this happens is termed the muscle full effect. So effectively, the muscle itself has incorporated all these dietary amino acids into the muscle, and the muscle actually becomes full due to a restriction at the actual level of the muscle fiber. It's like a physical space sort of thing. And I've linked a paper from Atherton that was published in the 2010 American Journal of Clinical Nutrition. You guys should check that out. It discusses this theory in great depth and also provides a nice review of the muscle protein synthesis response in general. So at present, we don't really have any data that suggests that any additional calories, fluids, protein, or anything else extend this period where the muscle protein synthesis actually returns to baseline and stays there regardless of any additional input. We call this a refractory period. It kind of seems like this just runs its course, you know, that 3 hours after you eat without any sort of perturbation by any additional dietary component. For example, there's some data on carbohydrate ingestion between meals that shows a decrease in muscle protein breakdown, but no effect on muscle protein synthesis, either the muscle protein synthesis response from the meal prior to the carbohydrate ingestion or after, suggesting that you could just eat between meals that do contain protein and you wouldn't really affect the muscle protein synthesis response. So obviously, this is a pretty complex topic, but my take on this matter is that the primary goals of any nutrition intervention are really twofold. So the first thing is any nutrition intervention should ensure compliance with the correct amount of calories needed to produce the desired outcome, whether that's fat loss, muscle gain, or weight maintenance. And then the second thing is the intervention should encourage adequate protein intake per meal in order to support muscle mass, which depends on a number of factors like muscle mass, age, medical history, current training, and total calorie level. For most, this tends to produce a protein recommendation that's somewhere in that 1.6 to 3.1 grams per kilo of body weight that's split up into 4 to 6 protein-containing meals per day. If a person needs to get additional calories in because they cannot eat enough in one sitting, for example, additional meals can be eaten between the main protein-containing ones, and this likely has no ill effect on muscle protein synthesis rates overall. Water and low-calorie beverages don't affect this as far as I can tell, and to that end, even calorie-containing meals probably don't negatively affect muscle mass outcomes in this context. Suffice it to say, things can get very complicated here, and I reserve the right to change my mind when presented with new information. All right, so this next question is from Perry Tate. He asks, "Hey Jordan, I wanted to ask a question about chiropractic care. I know it's a rather contentious subject to some people because of the claims by some chiropractors that their adjustments will fix way more things than they possibly could, and also the fact that some chiropractors attempt to work outside their scope of their own expertise. I personally knew one chiropractor who basically argued that everyone needed chiropractic adjustments at least 3 times a week for the rest of their lives. He was also one of the ones that would argue that adjustments would do things like boost your immune system and cure chronic pain throughout all areas of the body. On the other hand, I also know a chiropractor who seems like a much more genuine guy and gives adjustments and really basic health advice. And he has helped a fair number of people that I know with various pains, though he doesn't really adopt the biopsychosocial model of pain that you and others at Barbell Medicine have. With all that being said, is there evidence that chiropractors, and in particular, the correction of vertebral subluxations, help in a non-placebo way with any health issues people face? If so, who is it for and when would you recommend it?" So the medical definition of a subluxation is a partial dislocation, usually secondary to trauma, tends to produce damage to the ligaments around the joint, and that tends to cause pain and dysfunction that tends to get better over a series of weeks like sprains normally do. Now, the chiropractic definition of subluxation tends to be a little bit different and a little bit more squishy, and in general carries over to things like health in addition to pain and function. And it seems like that most of the chiropractic like organizations and like position papers, et cetera, are trying to like revise this definition of subluxation or maybe even move away from that theory, quote unquote. So I think this is an excellent time to phone a friend, get Dr. Michael Ray, our resident chiropractor and member of the Barbell Medicine staff, on the line and see what he thinks about this question.
Yeah, so there's currently like a schism going on in the profession, and there has been for quite some time, where there's this divide between those who are heavily rooted in outdated philosophy based around subluxation, and then the other side of the profession that's moved very much into the neuromusculoskeletal world for rehabilitative purposes. And there's been a lot of position statements that's come out recently from like the American Chiropractic Association and other organizations. So there's very much a push to separate away from this kind of old school mentality. I can say there's no supportive evidence whatsoever of any quality that should even be considered as research evidence to support the subluxation-based construct. A lot of schools and a lot of people talk about it as a theory. I don't even give it that title because that implies that we have substantial amount of evidence to support it. There is none. And it's really unfortunate that it's still getting utilized a lot in clinical practice to validate care, but also profit off of, unfortunately.
You have, you know, a group of trained individuals who are highly educated, because chiropractic school is not just like a fluff piece that you can go through. It does, you know, it is graduate or professional level education. It's just the central paradigm within the school has to be on some level, or is on some level, around subluxations and this, you know, biomedical model, only because if that were not the case, I'm not sure that the schools would still exist, and then the market would be significantly compromised for its graduates. So I'm not trying to throw all the chiropractic, you know, all of chiropractic care under the bus, more so like there's a real problem with identifying, like, what is the scope of practice? What are the like goals that you're trying to achieve? And as you spoke to, the evidence on this, on like spinal manipulation for like acute low back pain is not good. And in fact, the two best reviews that I could find, there's a 2012 Cochrane review that basically said there's no good evidence supporting, you know, manipulation for management of acute low back pain. There's some low quality evidence suggesting, you know, it moves you like 1 millimeter or whatever on the visual analog scale, or 1 centimeter, which is, I don't really know what to make of that. And then even more recently in 2017, there was a JAMA article effectively that found the same thing after reviewing all of the randomized controlled trials on this particular subject. So with that, and then your kind of knowledge of the biopsychosocial model and actually having dealt with patients with acute low back pain, they come in your office expecting to get a spinal manipulation. Yeah. You know, what is your, I mean, I guess three main questions. Question one, do you think that using the term spinal subluxation or vertebral subluxation is harmful? Do you adjust people to reduce these subluxations at all? And then when, if ever, do you think that's an appropriate treatment rendered by a chiropractic professional?
Those are good questions. I think it's pertinent to say first, like, the only differing factor here between a chiropractor doing a joint manipulation and a physical therapist is the narrative being supplied typically. So plenty of professions, osteopaths, physical therapists, chiropractors all do joint manipulations. The difference is the narrative that's being supplied in the chiropractic world is often rooted in this vertebral subluxation model, which has no evidence whatsoever. So with that said, I do think it is harmful. I think it's a net negative. Because it's similar to like myofascial trigger points. We're creating these problems in which we don't have evidence to say they actually exist. Like, no one has any validated diagnostic criteria to even attempt to find and locate vertebral subluxations, nor is it replicable, which means if, you know, basic like science 101 is if I can't identify it, I can't replicate it, then it doesn't exist up to this point. So then now we're intervening on this false narrative, and therefore it explains to the patient, like, oh, we'll use acute low back pain because you brought it up. You're having acute low back pain because you have a misaligned L4. I'm going to go ahead and fix it for you. Well, we know, like, A, that doesn't exist, but B, you've now conditioned both yourself and the patient to believe that this is necessary for them to get resolution from their pain symptoms. When in reality, we know the majority of acute low back pain is going to be nonspecific and it's going to rectify itself within 4 to 6 weeks. And there's no great cause for concern typically. So we've conditioned the person falsely to this unnecessary treatment, this unnecessary narrative. So to me, it's no different than any other false narrative that we kind of rally against at Barbell Medicine. And so that's unfortunate. So with that said, it kind of answers the next questions. I don't think there's any validity to it. I don't think there is an appropriate time to utilize it. And we would do worlds greater good if we could just move away from that narrative altogether as a profession.
Yeah, I'm in agreement with that. And the main thing I guess I would add to that is if somebody, one of my patients or clients or, you know, somebody close to me who was asking my opinion on this had a, you know, vested sort of interest or not vested interest, their, I guess, previous experience with chiropractors was positive and they really thought that was going to help them and they were looking for, you know, an improvement, and they said, hey, is it okay if I go to see a chiropractor? You know, on the one hand, I'm saying, well, your previous experience and this expectations of this intervention is likely going to render a positive experience in the short term, but the long term, you know, of that, not that it's harmful to see the chiropractor, you know, just in general, but rather if you get conditioned to believe that you do have a subluxation, there's something mechanically wrong that needs to be fixed and can only be done by these, you know, professionals, that's potentially harmful long term. And that's saying nothing of the potential risks of the cervical, you know, manipulation without identifying potential pathology there. So yeah, I probably would try to dissuade people from going to see the chiropractor if I expected that that was the experience they were going to have. On the other hand, if you were the chiropractor that they were going to go see, I'd probably be cool with it because I'm like, hey, man, you're going to go see this guy who I know is going to counsel you and provide some education and then also like practical interventions for how to get you back to where you were before. And that's ultimately what we're all shooting for. I just don't think that manipulation or adjustment of subluxations is the ticket to do that.
No, and I've written about this like extensively in the past, probably like 4 years ago or so. I released a blog on it, and then we had our podcast previously with it. The profession's uniquely poised to serve a purpose, especially in the neuromusculoskeletal world. Like, we have physician level status in all 50 states. We have direct access. If the case warrants it, you can order imaging. Like, there's so many positive things that the profession could have, but if we continue to make this our cornerstone, I don't see us being very valid in the future, most likely.
Yeah, I agree. And I'm also in agreement that there is a place for chiropractic care. It's just the sort of central paradigm of chiropractic medicine is like as far as what it is and its mission statements and how it's different from allopathic and osteopathic medicine needs to be more aligned with what is actually going on in the clinic and what is actually beneficial for patients. So
exactly.
This was our Barbell Medicine call to the bullpen with Dr. Michael Ray. So I'm going to link these folks to the Pain Science article on spinal manipulation, what do, the 2017 JAMA article, the 2012 Cochrane review on spinal manipulation for acute low back pain, and our previous podcast. Any other article that you think is super useful that I should link folks to read more about this?
So there's a couple of them. I don't know the names off the top of my head, but I can send them to you. But they talk about the failure to substantiate subluxation as a diagnostic issue. It's a really good one. It's a review article. There was also a review article released last year that really goes after the people that are claiming that they have health benefits, like preventative, primary and secondary preventative health benefits by having people come in and get joint manipulation through a chiropractor. And that basically goes after all of the health claims, like, oh, we mitigate cancer development. We make your ear infections go away. We like whatever all these ridiculous health claims are. It basically is like there is zero evidence to say this. So I think both of those would be two really good articles people could check out.
Very cool. And if people want to find out more about you, what you're putting out on the internets, how can people follow you, Mike?
Just I'm pretty active on Instagram. So Michael_barbellmedicine.
Hey. I like it. Very cool. All right, Mike, thanks for joining us here, and I'll let you get back to the sushi and hanging out with the wife. All right, so this next question is from J.D. Wu. He asks, hey, Jordan, this week should be my deload week, and the plan was one single at RPE 8, but the weight became RPE 10 when I pulled it. My question is, should I continue my deload week as normal, or should I deload longer? So my response to this is plan for the 8, execute the 8. Basically, your warm-ups on the way up to that single at RPE 8 should dictate whether or not your planned number that you had in mind is accurate based on your performance on that day. So I would want to know what the single at RPE 7 felt like prior to you loading up the bar for your single at RPE 8. Because if you would have done that single at 7, then you know based on your report here, that should have felt like a single at 8 or a single at 9. And then you would have been like, maybe I need to temper what I was going to go up to, or maybe I'm done with singles for the day. And how this applies to multi-rep sets, let's say you were trying to work up to a set of 5 at RPE 9, you should calculate your warm-up sets from your previous week's estimated 1RM and your previous week's working sets to try to figure out what your 5 reps at RPE 7 should be and what your 5 reps at RPE 8 should be. And then when you do those on the way up, that will kind of tell you, well, is my planned set at RPE 9 likely to be too much or not enough? That kind of gives you a little bit more accuracy there. On the other hand, if you mess up, there's probably no need to extend the week, but rather make sure you're completing the rest of the week with the appropriate intensity, volume, etc., so that the fitness adaptations you've previously trained can be realized, and also you can dissipate the fatigue, which is the purpose of a deload week in general. So again, I would spend a little bit more time planning your warm-ups, so that way your top work sets can be done with a little bit more accuracy. All right, so this last question is from Johnny Boy McConnell. He asks, thanks for all the data-based info and supporting resources. It makes it easier to challenge opinions based on bro science. I'm a powerlifter with no interest in competing, with an overarching goal of being strong for the rest of my life. I have an hour per day to work out. What percentages of my time should be spent on the main lifts, accessory lifts, or other resistance training and cardio? I'm currently doing about 60% barbell lifts, 20% accessory, that's kettlebells and calisthenics, and 20% cardio. So this is an interesting question. The first sort of feedback I would have is you're identifying as a powerlifter, but you have no interest in competing. And I think that if you're going to identify as a powerlifter, which means that you care most about 1RM improvements in the squat, the bench press, and the deadlift to the competition standard, then you're going to make compromises in your training that you otherwise wouldn't make if you weren't a competitive powerlifter. So for instance, a competitive powerlifter really has minimal use for the overhead press. It's a developmental lift. It's another pressing slot, but it's non-specific to the goal of getting your bench press up. So they probably wouldn't do as much pressing, for example. Also, they would do a lot of singles to get ready to go to the meet. Now, if you're never going to go to a meet, there's no real reason to hyper-specialize and get really good at singles and to only practice a certain amount of lifts. Rather, you would have more variety in both exercise selection and rep range. So that being said, just to get the wheels cranking in your head, I think that if you have no real specific goals, then we should pull from the existing data on what important training outcomes are for health. And those are lean body mass. We have good data suggesting that lean body mass levels tend to correlate with good health outcomes. And that's including avoiding things like sarcopenia and maintaining your functional capacity as you age. Same thing with strength. We have good data that the stronger you are, the more likely you are to live a full and complete life and be able to participate in all your normal activities of daily life and recreational pursuits that you deem important. And then also the cardiorespiratory capacity, you're basically just cardio. We know that having a certain level of cardiorespiratory development is associated with improved longevity and decreased morbidity of disease. So those would be the things I would be training for at large. As far as what sort of time you're going to dictate towards each one of those goals, it really depends on the individual. So a person with no cardio like baseline or capacity is probably going to have to spend more time doing cardio than somebody who comes from an endurance training background. Similarly, the person who comes from an endurance training background who has never trained with weights before probably should dedicate more time to doing resistance training than cardio. The thing is, I think if I'm going to make a blanket recommendation, that we're not going to find a better resource than the 2018 Physical Activity Guidelines for Adults. And I've linked those below in the description, so you should definitely check out that article. So basically right now, in the United States, only 26% of men, 19% of women, and 20% of adolescents are actually meeting the existing recommendations, which are to do 150 minutes of moderate to vigorous aerobic activity each week with resistance training or muscle strengthening activities 2 days per week. So not that many folks are actually meeting these minimum requirements. And so how I interpret the physical activity guidelines for adults is that people should be spending on average 2.5 hours training aerobically per week and about 2 hours to 2.5 hours doing resistance training per week, or a 50-50 split. Now, since you identify as a powerlifter and obviously you follow barbell medicine, so you're probably super interested in resistance training, I would kind of practically switch that to 3 resistance training sessions per week. You say you have an hour per day to train, so that's 3 hours per week. And then I would layer on 2 to 3 aerobic training sessions per week. How I typically do this, as I call them, GPP sessions, and those include cardio, some additional sort of accessory work. So that would be like 30 minutes of aerobic training or maybe some high intensity interval training work. I would have you do some upper back work, whether that's chin-ups, pull-ups, rows, something like that, that tickles your fancy. And usually I put a time cap on that. So it's like 7 or 8 minutes of as many reps as you can do in sets of like 8 to 12 reps at RPE 7 or 8 of pull-ups, for instance. And you just try to accumulate as many reps as possible in that time period. And I also include a little bit of trunk work, so or what people will classically call ab work, whether that's planks, V-sits, L-sits, strict toes to bar, ab wheel rollouts being my favorite. Again, you're spending 7 minutes. That's a good place to start. Just doing as many submaximal sets as you can. And again, that submaximal to me is like RP 7, RP 8. That's kind of so you don't go to failure at any of the sets. And then additionally, you could include some arm work at the end of that. And again, I like the sort of like time cap. You spend 7 minutes doing one triceps exercise and one biceps exercise to sets of 12 to 15 reps at RP 7 to 8 for each set. And then you're trying to increase either the volume or the weight that you're using to get the same volume on a weekly basis. But for you, again, it would be 3 sessions of resistance training per week, approximately, and 2 to 3 sessions of aerobic training. That's kind of how I would apply the physical activity guidelines for adults to somebody who doesn't really have a specific goal. And then again, like we led this question off with, I'm not sure if I would identify as a powerlifter and let that sort of guide my training if I didn't plan on competing. So with that being said, if you did want to go compete, how this would change is that more of your time would be dedicated towards lifting as you got closer and closer to the meet. So again, even if you only have 1 hour a day to train, which is fine, then I would start spending 4 hours per week doing resistance training as you got closer to a meet, then maybe 5 hours per week doing resistance training as you got closer to the meet. And then maybe that would turn to 6 hours, you know, for a few weeks as you kind of built up as much sort of training fatigue as you were going to get for a particular training block. And then as you went into the meet, we would start pulling back stress. So you peaked nicely for your meet. And that's how I would do it. All right. So now let's look at some form checks that you guys have submitted and some of our own training. All right. So first up here is Tim Henricks. Looks like, was this 335? Yeah, your elbows are a little high and then the depth is a little too much. I'd cut an inch off the depth. So it'd squat an inch higher. And I'd have you pull your elbows down before you even start the rep. I mean, I've struggled with that literally my entire squatting career. So I get it, but that would be my cue to you. All right, so this is Bob Quindazzi. I guess, oh, the post-it note says 225. All right, cool. So this is high bar. Yeah, and you see the knees coming forward, just trying to get depth on the way down. So the depth is a little, it's just a little high. And it looks like your stance is really narrow right now. So what I would do is widen, oh, there goes the post-it note. Yeah, and you can tell that the stance is narrow because the bar drifts forward at the bottom. So I would widen the stance, push your knees forward and out to give yourself some room to squat all the way down. The other thing I would do is make sure you're squatting with some safeties because, yeah, like that last one was a little hard. But I think that'll help your bar path and it'll help your depth. So it's a little bit wider with your stance. Toes are going to be still angled out. Knees go forward and out. So this is Cody. This is 185 pounds. Oh, I thought it was kilograms. No, 185. And he's going to do 8. Okay. So we'll get you to check out, make sure his butt stays on the bench. Yeah. So I don't like that your head's coming off the bench on the way down. Like, it's not a huge deal. I would just keep it down. So I wouldn't like try to lift it off, but you know, that's the thing. The pauses look fine. The bar path looks good. So what you're looking at from this orientation is the tip of the elbow, the olecranon process in front of the barbell, just a little bit. That signifies a vertical forearm because the radius is the, load-bearing bone in this orientation. Looks pretty good, and your wrists aren't moving around. That's fine. Just look really light. So thanks, man. All right, Dace. I'm trying to see what this perspective is like. This is pause bench. Now, I can't be certain, but I detect that you're flaring a lot, and I think it's because your grip's too narrow. Now, I can't tell from this angle. You don't have a spotter, which I don't love, although you don't have clips. But yeah, the bar's going forward off your chest instead of back. So the bar's forward right there. The tip of the elbow is not in front of the barbell. So I would have you tuck your elbows in and elbows go forward a little bit more on the way down. And then, yeah, I mean, that's why. Ooh, yep. See, that's a hard one. And your feet are moving around. Hey, Dace, look, man, get a spotter or at least use some spotting arms if you can't. So that way you don't, you know, inadvertently kill yourself. And the problem is your grip is a little too narrow for how long your arms are. And so right now, as you're doing a lot of this, a lot of flaring, which isn't necessarily a bad thing, but I think for optimum mechanics for you, I would widen your stance. I would tuck your elbows in a little bit more. Make sure that the tip of your elbow is touching in front of the bars, in front of the bar at the bottom, which you can verify from this angle. And then you have to push the bar back off your chest instead of straight up. That would be my advice for you. All right. So this next one is going to be from Perry. Let's look at some deadlifts. Yeah, that looks pretty good. I think you could squeeze your chest up just a hair more. I see just a little bit at your spine. It's just a little inflection at the start. And I think you could just volitionally squeeze it up. It was just a really easy set. So hard to say, but pretty good. This is Tom from Vietnam. I just wanted to say that. Was it 70, 80, 85 kilos? Yeah, bar's forward of the middle of the foot there. So I would move the bar back in your stance, raise your hips up a little bit. And then, it's just a little forward. Your back looks fine. The weight is, still pretty light. So feel free to go up, but I would move the bar back in your stance. It's just a little forward, which you would find out at heavier loads. Okay, so this is Austin. Now, hold on. I'm going to pause it right here for a sec. So check this out. So Austin has just been on a tear recently. Like his squat was going bananas for a while and his bench was going bananas. And now I guess it's time for his deadlift to go bananas. Now, the truth is both of us can't be strong at the same time. The universe has it out for us, one of us at all times. So right now it's his time to be strong. And then, I feel like my time's coming, the next month or two. I feel some good things happening. I'm back to normal training. So let's see what happens. Now, let's just admire this. So this is 705 on the bar. He's at Iron Asylum in Virginia. Let's check this out. Got a nice sweat pant hike. Yeah, dude. That was a sick pull, man. Congratulations. If you haven't checked him out on Instagram and said congrats on 705, huge accomplishment. Nice work. All right, so this is his wife. This is 155. This is from her meet. Yeah. And so what they're going to do from here is jump up to 162.5. So that's a 7.5 kilo jump, 15 pounds. I think her best was 165 in the gym. And she didn't have to cut any weight for this. So, this should have been fine. Now, what you'll notice, so she's walked out here. She's ready to squat. That's not the longest squat hold I've seen, but I think she just gets out of position. There's a little shift there. Yeah. Probably would have liked to squat more heading into the meet, but still, So she goes into bench with 155, smokes this one. I believe this was 97.5. No, this is 97.5. So that was 92.5. This is 97.5. Look how long that pause was. Like, dude. So that was actually 100. Sorry, she started at 97.5, went to 100. This is 102.5. Yeah, that pause wasn't even that long as the one before. Nice job. Suzanne in the background showing support. So she's got 155 on the squat. She's got 102.5 on a bench. Goes into deadlifts. Yeah, 172.5 smoked. This is all at 63 kilo body weight. That's a good looking singlet too, Lorraine. Nice. 182.5 on the bar. 401. 402, smoked. Now 187.5. This is 411, something like that. I wish the lighting would be better here, but all right. 187.5. Lorraine, you probably had more in you. All right, so now this is me squatting. It's 495. First time I've been close to 500 since the little hip thing that I've been dealing with. So that moved pretty well. And now I move down. I do six sets of six here. So this is 385. I think, looking at these now, I probably would go about a half inch lower. Although sometimes I say that and then nothing, it doesn't change. I've never been called on depth in a meet, but still for my own edification, I would probably go a little lower and try to keep my elbows down a little bit better. So this is 515, a little bit better depth than 595. Still moves pretty fast, so I'm hoping my squat's going up. Now I did six sets of six at 405. Yeah, again, I really think the biggest feedback here is just at the top, I'd like to consciously pull my elbows forward again. There you go. I got them down there. And then I'd probably just go a half inch lower just for the tubes, you know. So what is this, 395 after squatting? I rated this an 8. The bar path wasn't great, though. It's a little forward off my chest. And then I did 7 sets of 4 at 315. This is just one of the sets. And looking at these, I think, you know, 2 out of 4 of those pauses were great. All right, now moving on to some deadlifts. So this is 585 plus 112 in chain. So this is 697. Now, all the chain links aren't going to be off at the top. So I'm going to go ahead and call this like 670-something. 660-something. Yeah, it's pretty good. All right, here's the second set. So this is what, 495, 545, 535 plus chains. So maybe like 630-something. Because it's 112 in chains. So you can see that the plates are all the way at the end of the bar. And I like doing that so I can put the chains on the inside of the bar without the chains actually getting underneath the plates. And I just took the time to tell you that because I didn't see anything wrong with my deadlifts. I didn't see the bar rolling forward. I didn't see my back getting out of position from this angle. Should film from the side for the next time so we can talk about back angles during the deadlifts. But that's been this week's edition of training vlog number 29. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you want your own question, your own videos reviewed right here on the YouTube channel, send us your submission, media@barbellmedicine.com. Please turn your phone sideways. and you can use something like WeTransfer to send a larger file. That would be great for us. We would love to see your squats and your presses and your benches and your deadlifts. Would all be good. And anyway, thanks for tuning in. We'll catch you guys next time. See ya.